council even got to ask the executive director of the Humane Society, who came out here, and I believe that's by design. You know, we're all doing what our wards are telling us to. We represent different wards. We represent rural wards and we represent urban wards, but I believe a dog is a dog is a dog. And in terms of what we want better for our... Dogs are no longer possessions. And I can debunk that security myth that, you know, dogs are you know, protecting livestock and, you know, it's just not effective. If you do your research, you can learn about that too.
Thank you. Councillor Bjorkman.
Thank you, Your Worship. I'm not looking to be a trailblazer as much as Councillor Bondi in this effort, but I've tried to do some research and look at what the intent is of moving this bylaw. I had some conversation with Ms. Coulter, and she shared with me some of the reasons that we're pushing for this. It's not always the tethering that's the issue. The tethering generates a lot of things. Oftentimes, the tethering complaints, shelter complaints, general welfare complaints are all blurred. Those issues are blurred, but what happens is that dog is on a tether outside by itself and unattended. When the dogs are unattended, that's when there's a problem. I will be asking to adjust a couple things in the bylaw with regard to unattended tethering. But I'm not in favor of leaving it at 12 hours because it's not enforceable. In talking with other people, with our animal control officers, getting the data that we have had less than 20 reports in the last 3-4 years that are directly linked that we know of to tethering. But when they did go out to try to help those animals, there was a couple animals they couldn't help because they couldn't stay out there for more than 12 hours and collect their data. So the idea is not here to suddenly we're going to put a 4-hour tether limit and we're going to tell everybody out there, okay, we're sending the police out every day and we're going to make sure anybody who's out more than 4 hours, you're going to be reported. It's not a huge issue now. One of my problems with this was, why are we doing this if we have so little issue with it, if so few items are being reported? But it's not that the tethering is being reported so little. It's a lot of the issues we're having are because dogs are tethered. So in order to move past that and to treat these animals properly, we already have in our bylaw that they need shelter. We have in our bylaw that they need to have care, food, water, shelter, exercise, attention. An unattended dog is not getting those things. So I will not be voting in favor of leaving it at 12 hours for those reasons.
Anyone else? I'll come back to you as the mover of the motion. Councillor Snively.
Through Your Worship, I kind of agree with Councillor Bjorkman. I'm not in favor of the 12 hours either. I would look at something like Amherstburg's got the 10-hour tethering. For the reason is people work 8 hours. Let's say it takes them an hour to get to work or in an hour to get home. So I'd be looking at 10 hours. I think 12 hours is too long to tether a dog, but I would be looking at 10 hours. Thank you.
I have a couple comments. I kind of agree with just about a few things that everyone said. Kind of more so with Councillor Caxero. I've had farmers who have dogs that don't want this. You know, the 12 hours might not even be enough for them. That's the rural area. I can see where Deputy Malosh is coming from. Rural area is, just like Councillor Bondi says, a child is a child is a child. Well, a rural area is a rural area, which is a rural area. Try say that a lot of times and real fast. You know, the town people, yeah, like I can't see where they need to have that dog out there for 12 hours. I can see, because kids go to school, they're not gone all that time. Most of them are big enough to let the dog off the chain if he's in the yard. But the rural area is different. To me, we need two sets, two standards. Rural and you know, town people, different. To me, that's what I'm saying. I'm sitting here, I'm all for the 4, but I'm all for the 12. Which way am I gonna vote? when the question's called, I guess I'll make up my mind then. I'll have to. But right now, I'm not sure. I want to see one set for the town people and one set for the farm people. That's where I'm at. Deputy Mayor Milosh, you have the floor.
Thank you, through you, Your Worship. Well, I've heard of a lot of assumptions. Dogs like crates, and they're happy and comfortable. 12 hours locked in their crates, whether they like it or whether they don't, and they have to hold their bladders, to me, you'd be much better to be outside on a chain and be able to do your business. The reason why they like these crates, it's called conditioning. I've heard some swaying in what council wants to hear. I'm willing to adjust the motion to 10 hours tethering, as Councillor Snively was suggesting. And I would also like to add to the motion, if the seconder is okay with it, that we also write in conditions of the shelter that should be provided along with tethering to ensure that those dogs that are being tethered have the proper shelter to be out of the elements, be out of the cold, out of the rain, out of the sun, and that it's properly insulated to protect them. So I don't know if we can come up with the exact prototype or the exact answer on the conditions or the shelter standard, but I'd like to have it built in to the motion that we do at a further point in time come up with a standard for that particular shelter, but that it would include insulated doghouse if they're going to tether their dog outside for 10 hours at a time. So, Mr. Mayor, I'd like to make that change.
We have changes to the motion, and Mr. Auger, have that down? Councillor Cancero?
Bill, second.
Okay. Mrs. Hunter?
Your Worship, the bylaw as it's written right now under responsibility to care for animals provides that you provide a shelter for your animals that protects that animal from the elements and that it's adequate in size, and that'll be very much dependent on the animal that you're sheltering it versus a dachshund versus a so to try and define it precisely as to what that size should be, I think it would be very difficult, but I think we've already covered off the fact that they need to provide a shelter and it needs to protect them from the elements, so the cold, the water, and so on.
So I'll strike that part of it then, because
okay.
It sounds like we already are covered.
Now, am I opening this up to discussion again because we have a new motion?
Well, we frankly have a new motion.
Yeah, that's what I'm asking the clerk. Do we do that? Okay, F. Cutler, Cacero.
To Your Worship, I think the whole idea of maybe being a little more definitive with the shelter, and I know what Deputy Mayor Milosh is alluding to. I think if it's just defined as adequate for heat and cold and providing shelter out of the rain and whatnot, out of the elements, then it becomes, I guess, the bylaw enforcement officer or the animal control officer's discretion as to whether or not they feel that that's adequate. And I understand what Mrs. Hunter is saying. It's hard to define because it could be a different definition depending on the dog. But without defining it, if I'm, let's say I'm getting a dog and I'm going to be tethering the dog and I know I have to provide a shelter for it, I may want to know what I need to go and buy. I want to buy whatever I need to buy. It might cost me $300 or $400 to go and buy it, but I want to know what it is that I got to buy for it to be adequate. So is there some way that people are going to be able to contact and ask somebody as to what's going to provide an adequate shelter for my dog being X dog, because I think that would be important. I know there's varying dog houses out there. Some provide both relief from heat and cold, depending on how they're insulated and where the door is and all that kind of stuff. But I think some people are going to need some guidance on that.
Okay, I have Mrs. Hunter, Director of Corporate Services, and the Treasurer.
Through you, Your Worship, I believe our animal control offices could provide that information if somebody so wanted to have a better idea of what they should make available. I think the thing is in terms of size, it's very difficult to standardize that size given the different species of dogs, but certainly I think our animal control officers having, they're also not animal control officers, they're trainers and so on, that they have a good sense of what would be acceptable to them in terms of if they were looking at that shelter, would it be suitable?
That, I guess, I don't know whether there's something that needs to be put in the bylaw to that effect, or whether it's more of an educational campaign that we need to do to make sure that people know that this information could be provided to them if they need it.
Through Your Worship, our animal control officers have been very good at educating. I think in my email today when I asked about instances where we've had complaints, that their thrust is to try and solve the situation without fines. And obviously, if there is a way of making sure that a dog is comfortable and well cared for, that if, you know, if we want to get that word out to people that they're available to make that call for them, then we can certainly do that with our animal control officers.
Thank you. Councillor Bondi.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor. I think what we're failing to realize is that if a dog is cared for, there's no issue. The reason why we're trying to put teeth in the bylaw is so that it's enforceable. If we have a 10-hour limit, you need a 12-hour workday shift in order to be able to enforce that. Because if you need to be able to see those whole 10 hours, so you need a 12-hour workday. A 12-hour limit means you almost need like a 14-hour workday. So what happened was is the deputy mayor made a motion, and then he keenly picked up that the motion wasn't going to pass because Councillor Snidely wasn't going to support the four. Then he tweaked his motion. Now Councillor Snidely's on board, the mayor's on board, and so anybody that supports 4 hours, it's a 4-3 right now. So we've had different conversations about an urban rule. I'd like to add a friendly amendment that it's 4 hours in the urban areas and 8 hours in the rural areas. 8 hours means we can enforce it in wards 2 and wards 3. 4 hours means we can have not barking for 5+ hours in wards 1 and 4. It's a hybrid. It's enforceable. I think Councillor Bjorkman talked about, you know, we have different cultures in our municipality. Mr. Mayor, you were saying tonight that rule is rule, and my point was a dog is a dog is a dog. I don't want to penalize a dog for living in a rural area versus an urban area, but the points being made about dogs being outside when they want to be outside is valid. I get that. Like, you know, you know, if families are outside and if dogs are attended to and dogs are cared for, dogs can be tethered perfectly fine. It's in those cases where the dogs are literally neglected. They're the phrase, forgotten dog. If you have a dog out there for 10 hours or 12 hours, it's a forgotten dog. It no longer becomes part of the family. And that's where I stress again that change is hard. Yes, this is hard. Yes, if we pass this, you, Mr. Mayor, might take some hit in a coffee shop by a farmer that says, how dare you stop me from chaining my dog? Well, that's a battle I'm willing to take. That's a good battle to fight. So I'd like to propose a friendly amendment for 4 hours in the urban areas and 8 hours in the rural areas because our municipality is a little bit different than the city of Windsor and a lot of it different than LaSalle. So it's a good hybrid mix. It appeases, I probably think it could almost appease everybody at this table, maybe not the deputy mayor, but we've all said that we have rural, and we all said that we have urban, and the issues in Harrow Center are dogs barking, and the issues in farmland are, you know, they want the security measure. So that's it.
Okay, if I just may, to Councillor Bondi, like you made a statement that we can look after a dog in 8 hours, you know, so, but we can in 12 or 10 because our enforcement officers aren't working that. I think that's what it is. So how do we police this? Do you plan on having one of our enforcers.
To the point of, a point of order, Mr. Mayor, this is going to go on.
Well,
first, we need to see if they're going to accept that amendment or it's not worth talking about. She made a friendly amendment. Will they accept the amendment?
Okay.
If they do, then we need to talk about it.
Because if she can convince me to vote, I need to have this answered. And a friendly amendment to the motion.
I think it's more than a friendly amendment. I think it's a whole new motion. So we'll go with what we have, and then she can make that a motion if it fails.
Okay, fine. Now, further to Councillor Bondi, our plans, your plans, to have that enforcement officer, because somebody's tied up for 10 hours or 8 hours, sit there to, or how, like you say, we can't police 12 or 10, but we can 8 or
12 6. And 10 is very challenging. I think what council need, the only thing council needs to understand is that this bylaw will only be used in cases of abuse. Those cases of abuse are most likely found by the Humane Society, found by neighbors, found by people that are concerned about a particular dog. If people aren't concerned about a particular dog, we will probably, in theory, maybe use this bylaw once a year. If we're talking about cases of abuse, which is why this we are doing this whole thing right now, 12 hours and 10 hours is virtually impossible. You might as well do that. If you have 8 hours, we can watch it. If the animal's not abused and it's out on the chain for 12 hours and it's fine, it's not going to get reported anyways. That's why this is by. It's you have to think about in that case of abuse, we can enforce the 8 hours. We can barely enforce the 10 and probably never enforce the 12. That's what it's
but
for.
But my question is, how can we enforce the 8 hours? Sit there for 8 hours? Oh, okay. That's all I needed to know.
And if there's a bad case of abuse and somebody has to sit there once a year to get that one case, then that's what needs to be done.
Those are our building inspectors that do this to Mrs. Hunter?
Through your worship, animal control officers.
Hired. Okay. Okay, I got it. Thanks. I have Councilor Vogt.
If I could too, Councilor Bondi, I'm trying to understand the 8 hours rurally, and I'm sorry, but in the 4 hours, because I just assume an animal, it's like owner convenience, that's what it is. And I look at the animal coming from the same litter. I get one living in Essex, and you get one living in the county. Your animal can be tied up for 8, and mine only has to be tied up for 4. So what's the advantage to that in terms of the animal? Let's forget about the owner. Let's protect
point
the animal.
Point of order, Your Honor, we have a motion on the table with regard to 10 hours. That's what we're discussing now.
Right.
If that fails, we'll carry on with the next discussion.
That's what we're doing.
Okay. We have to vote on the motion.
She wants an amendment to it.
He said it's been turned down.
It wasn't accepted.
All right,
Councillor. Yeah, Councillor Snively.
Through your worship, just to a comment that Councillor Bondi made. I just want to say one thing. What's the difference if the dog's tied up for an hour or 10 hours? If it's abused, it's abused. The dog can be abused in an hour. So.
Okay. Now to the new motion, the motion maker. Oh. Point of information. Yep. When we get there, I was going to deal with that. Deputy Mayor Malash, you made the second motion, so you have the floor.
Thank you, through your worship. Again, I can't see it being any less than 10 hours. If it's not at least 10 hours for those individuals, and yes, it is a matter of convenience for some people who are working full-time and live alone. They have an animal that they cannot trust in the house. It's not conditioned to go into a crate. It wants to be outside. There are dogs that like being outside and like being tethered, whether you think there are or not. Because I have seen people with dogs that tether them, and they go to that doghouse and say, here, boy, that dog comes right over and is more than happy to be tethered. No problem. Doesn't run away from the doghouse. Doesn't run away from the person trying to tether them. It's called conditioning. So I think for those persons that need to use tethering, as long as they have sufficient shelter for the animal, keep them from the elements, keep them fed and watered. You can't be there 24 hours a day, 7 days a week. Stupid is stupid. If they're not smart enough to be kind to their animal and make sure it's got water and food, there's not a lot that we can do to try and stop that. That can happen inside the house just as well as outside of the house, whether they're tethered or whether they're in a crate. All I'm saying is that there are individuals, and there's not a lot of them, but we need to, in the farming community, allow for the tethering of animals, dogs in particular, for persons who are alone. Let's say, for instance, I'm trying to think of examples here, that work in the city. They tether their dog in the morning, they go into work, they come home, they untether their dog, bring them in the house, play with them, whatever they're going to do with them. Also, dogs that wander at night. There's a lot of farmers, I should say not a lot anymore, but there used to be more than what there are now. But there are farmers who use tethering outside because their dogs, and you've got to remember, in rural Essex, it's not like urban centers where they're every yard is fenced in pretty well. In a rural area, you have larger lots, acre to 2 acres. You're not going to fence the entire lot. Dogs are allowed to roam. So if they roam and they tend to roam outside of their yard area, sometimes they have to be tethered in order to keep them at home. They're outside maybe with the owners that are there, but they're tethered. So I've made some reduction here to 10 hours. We've got a good bylaw as far as our bylaw indicates good sheltering for these animals when they're outside. And as far as reducing it to 8 and having somebody have to sit there for 8 hours, it's not that much of a stretch to go to 10 hours. And whether you have to do that with 2 people or you pay somebody overtime, if that's what needs to happen. And as I heard here earlier, how often it's going to happen? Is it once a year? Is it once in 6 years? And I also believe that if there's some abuse happening, I would hope that it wouldn't be take just the fact that you've got to know that they've been tethered for 12 hours or 10 hours or 8 hours or 4 hours in a day when they're not supposed to have been, that that's the reason why we go in and take the animal or take action. If there's neighbors saying that there's an animal in my neighborhood that is under duress, we should be being proactive, and there may not be anything that we can do, but by that person knowing that they're being watched, it would hopefully cause a situation where this person would straighten out their act. So that's all, Mr. Mayor, that I can say. Thank you.
Okay, I'm ready for Councilor Bundy. You would like a record of vote? Yes. Okay, thank you very much.
This was our attempt at being proactive.
Yeah.
Sorry. So through your worship, on the motion to receive report 2017-07 and to amend bylaw 1574 to limit the amount of time for tethering of animals to 10 hours per day. Councillor Bondi, how do you vote?
Opposed.
Councillor Vokes?
Opposed.
Councillor Bjorkman?
Opposed.
Councillor Caxero?
Support.
Councillor Snively?
Support.
Deputy Mayor Milosh?
Support.
Mayor McDermott?
Support. Until there's a two system.
So on the recorded vote, Councillor Bondi opposed, Councillor Vokes opposed, Councillor Bjorkman opposed, Councillor Caxero support, Councillor Snively support, Deputy Mayor Milosh support, and Mayor McDermott support. With a recorded vote of 4 in support and 3 opposed, the motion carries. Point 2 on the agenda is building report 2017-03, the March 2017 building report for receipt.
Moved by Counselor Gaxero, supported by Deputy Mayor Milosh. Any questions? Counselor Snively.
Through your worship, to Chris, how many new starts did we have? Do you know off the top of your head?
Through your worship, I noted in the report the single family residential, there are four permits were issued. But I don't know in which wards they were issued. That's just.
Just four. Yeah. Okay, thank you.
Thank you. Any further? All in favor? Motion carries 5-2.
Item 8.3 is Community Services Report 2017-010, Office Accommodation and Life Cycle Report Update. Said report is for receipt and for council to direct administration to set up a reserve account to allocate funds annually for a new town hall facility starting in the 2018 budget. And also the council directs administration to review the options proposed by Stevenson Engineering and prepare a business plan to be presented to council prior to the official 2018 budget deliberations. And I believe this evening we have our Director of Community Services, Mr. Sweet, speaking to this item.
Mr. Sweet, Director of Community Services.
Through your worship, I just want to give council a quick synopsis. It's a pretty lengthy report. Hopefully you had an opportunity to go through it. I just want to go through. The office accommodation review was conducted in the fall of 2016 by Stevenson Engineering and looked at the current town hall and guest hall office building. The purpose of the study was not to decide if a town hall should be built or to select a location, but the purpose was to see if the current two facilities are functional for municipal use and explore the option of combining staff at the two facilities under one roof to provide better customer service. The current town hall footprint is approximately 10,000 square feet, and from the review, Stevenson Engineer recommended that a new town hall would require approximately 21,000 square feet of space, recommended combining the staff at Gasto and Town Hall, and proposed a new footprint. Proposed footprint would also account for future staffing needs. Stevenson Engineering anticipated that over the next 3 years, the cost required for repairs or replacement of items at these two facilities may cost approximately $750,000. In addition, as council is aware, there's currently a fire master plan underway, and the new fire station location may be recommended, which would affect the use of the guest office facility. Stevenson Engineering did provide a few options on future town hall locations. One is to renovate the current town hall. This would require adding a second story to the current footprint. Another option was a brand new location. They provided three options. All are next to the Essex Center Sports Complex, which is owned by the town of Essex. And a third option, which they didn't explore in detail, was trying to locate in this building. So the council report in front of you tonight is just asking of two things: that funds begin to be set aside for new town hall starting in 2018, and this is to be proactive as per the recent asset management plan, and a direct administration to come back to council prior to the 2008 budget deliberations with a business plan on the best option for a new town hall, be it renovating or a new location, looking at the pros and cons of all the options. Thank you, worship.
Thank you for that, sir. Questions? Comments? Councilor Caicedo.
Through your worship, and I think I know the answer to the question. It was probably because we don't own the property. I assume the consultant was never told or asked to consider the Harrow High School as a potential option, being as there's 68,000 square feet there, so it'd be more than adequate to house the 21,000 that the report suggests. And I guess second to that, would administration consider that as an option if the property is acquired?
Mr. Sweet.
Through your worship, you are correct. Their scope, because it wasn't town-owned, it was still with the school board, they didn't feel they could list that as an option at that time. And secondly, if that is one of the options council would like administration to explore in terms of pros and cons, we definitely could include that location.
Councilor Caicedo.
So just further to that, I guess it would be a wait-and-see approach. I think if the property was acquired, at which point it was acquired, we're going to look at the different options as far as how we use that space, or if we're going to relieve ourselves of the building, or there's a number of options that we can look at. But I would suggest that at that point, if we do acquire the property, that I would leave that open as an option to explore, because I think that would be potentially a lot cheaper option.
you, sir. Anyone else? Councilor Bjorkman.
Thank you, through your worship. Thanks for putting this together and working with the committee to, or the company to give us this information. I just think it's worth noting that a new build, if we were to build a new town hall over at the Essex Sports Center, it's actually cheaper to do that than any of the renovations in our existing building. In order to put an addition on and renovate what we have, there's a $500,000 difference. It's a $500,000 savings to actually build a brand new building. So that's one of the things to keep in mind as we're talking about, even with the Harrow High School, it's a great, there's a structure there, but the cost when we get into renovating, it surprised me that it was actually cheaper to build brand new than to renovate our existing area. Anyways, just, and then right now we're looking at within the next 10 years to 15 years, we're going to have to, between the Gesto office and this office, we're looking at $1.7 million just in upkeep and work we're going to have to do if we do nothing at this point. So now is the right time to be looking at this, and appreciate the administration's work there. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. Anyone else? Okay, you have the report and the recommendation. Councilor Cactero.
Make a motion to receive the report and move the recommendations.
Thank you. Supported by Councilor Snively. Questions to that motion? All in favor? Motion carries.
8.4 on the agenda is Planning Report 2017-17, read Town of Essex Official Plan Public Meeting for receipt and support.
Moved by Councilor Bjorkman, supported by Councilor Cactero. Any questions? All in favor? Motion carries. Thank you.
8.5 is Corporate Services Report, Clerk 2017-02, re-Municipal Election 2018 Voting Method. This report is looking for Council's support of the recommendation that a traditional paper ballot system with optical scan vote tabulators be used for the 2018 municipal election, and if so supported, that bylaw 1598 receive three readings this evening.
Moved by Councilor Snively, supported by Councilor Bondi. Questions? Councilor Bondi.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor, and to our clerk. It was actually really refreshing to read, considering that we had a lot of, I would say, hurdles during the last two elections that I've experienced with vote by mail. And I think we will get some kickback. I think people were getting the hang of vote by mail, but I think a return to the polls is just really logical, and it makes sense considering everything that we're doing with our ward boundaries. One question I do have is, will we have an advanced poll in McGregor and an advanced poll in Harrow ahead of time? I just want reassurance on that one more time, please.
Through your worship, yes, absolutely. There would be, under this scenario, there would be advanced polls, at least the two that you're thinking of. We still have to look at the feasibility of if whether more than that would needed, but two. And then together with that, there would also be specialty polls set up at retirement places, long-term care facilities, that sort of thing, in order to try to facilitate accessibility and, you know, and give some more options as far as voting.
Thank you, Councilor Bondi. Anything else? All in favor? Motion carries.
Item 10 on the agenda, any updates from County Council?
None here. Deputy Mayor Malash, no. We're okay. Okay, thank you.
Item 11 is correspondence. 11.1, correspondence to be received. That the correspondence listed in agenda item 11.1 be received and where indicated to further share with the community using suitable methods of communication.
Moved by Councilor Bjorkman, supported by Councilor Bondi. Any questions or with regards to any of them? Councilor Bondi.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor. Perhaps this question is to yourself or perhaps our Deputy Mayor or Councilor Snively. I believe the two of you are on the Landfill Liaison Committee. I'm just wondering if you could bring back an update to Council of how much auto shredder fluff is being put in there, and maybe we could have a tabulation of, since say 2010, you know, auto shredder fluff 2010, 2011 in the amounts, because I remember when I was on that committee that it was really concerning for the various reasons why, and I think that council should be aware of how much auto shredder fluff is in there.
I know we have dealt with that at the Solid Waste Authority, and it saved us a lot of money when we were able to get it, but they got a better price someplace else, and then we weren't using it. I couldn't tell you right now if we are or aren't right now, but I will find that out for you. Deputy Mayor Malosh.
Actually, I'm going to say that I'm not so sure if it was saving the money, but it was earning the money, because they're paid for bringing in auto shredder fluff. But last term of council, when Councillor Bondi and myself were on the committee, I had brought that forward, actually, because I noticed that the coverage that they were using, the shredder fluff that they were bringing in, amounted to 25% of everything that was being brought in. But the town of Essex didn't collect anything on it. And because they were saying that, oh, this is coverage, that they were able to keep the revenue 100% for themselves. And I brought it up, and Councillor Bondi, we brought it up at the last council, and I had suggested that we perhaps get a lawyer to take a look at it to see if there's some precedence on what amount of shredder coverage is the correct amount. Can it be 25% of everything that's brought in be the correct amount? I think it's overboard myself, but we'll definitely bring that back.
Nope, we haven't voted. All in favor of receiving all of that information? Motion carries.
Agenda item 11.2.1, that the correspondence from Community Living Essex County asking council to consider declaring May as Community Living Month in the town of Essex and to acknowledge their organization by flying a flag at the town hall for 1 week in May be received and supported.
Moved by Councillor Caxero and Councillor Bjorkman. Supports. Any questions? All in favor of that motion? Motion carries.
11.2.2, resolution from the municipality of Port Hope calling on the province to ban incineration for receipt or receive and support, and if council chooses to so support, a letter be sent to the Premier of Ontario, the Ministry of the Environment and Climate Change, and the municipality of Port Hope.
Councillor Snivy? With the letter. Motion to receive and support. Seconded by Councillor Caxero. Any discussion? I have a little bit. I've heard in the past, probably 6 or 8 years ago, at the Essex Winter Solid Waste meetings, that Mayor Eddie Francis at the time said, the future is in incineration. Now, that was quite a few years ago. That's why the City of Windsor wants to fill that landfill as fast as they can to save their taxpayers. That's one of the reasons. Fill it up. Now, if we go to the government and ban incinerating garbage, and it comes soon after or before our landfill is filled, we got to worry about finding another piece of property to site another landfill. When that'll be, who knows, or it may never happen. But I know I would hate to have this passed and then us need, in the future, the province goes incinerating. You know, like, I suppose we could change it, or we could go back and say, oh, we want to incinerate now. Like, can we do that? I don't know. What do you call a flip-flop? But that's why I'm not prepared to vote for this. Councillor Caxero.
Through your worship, I think the whole idea of this is that it wouldn't be allowed to be done in Ontario at all. So if it wasn't, then it wouldn't. So to your point of if it's going to be allowed, well, this would not allow it to happen.
Exactly.
So therefore, nobody'd be able to do it. Landfills would have to continue. Yes, there'd have to be a new location selected, and I'm sure that that's all part of the process. Prior to that landfill being decommissioned, there's going to be a new site selected, whether it's in our municipality or not, who knows. But I'm sure the Solid Waste Authority would do their due diligence and have that selected prior to that landfill expiring. So I don't have a concern. I mean, if it's banned, it's banned for everybody. If it's not banned, whether we support this or not, if it's not banned, we'd still be able to do it. It's not as though we're tying our hands, and it wouldn't be banned in Ontario, but because we supported banning it, then we wouldn't be able to do it. That's the way I understand it, anyway.
Well, you're probably right, but I'd hate to be the deciding vote that says no when we didn't want it, if this area didn't want it. But anyways, good. Ready for the question?
No.
Oh, Councilor Bjorkman.
I won't vote in favor of this because I don't know anything about it. I don't know about incineration. I started to read a little bit, but I didn't have enough time. So I won't blindly support this motion because I really don't understand everything around it. So that's my view.
That it? All in favor of this motion? Opposed? Okay. Motion carries. Thank you.
Item 2 is committee meeting minutes. That the meeting minutes listed in agenda item 12 be received and adopted as presented, together with approval of any recommendations noted in.
Moved by Councilor Bjorkman, supported by Deputy Mayor Milosz. Questions? All in favor? Motion carries.
Item 13 under financial, 13.1, January 2017 bank payments report for ratification as submitted.
By Councilor Bjorkman, supported by Deputy Mayor Milosz. Questions? All in favor? Motion carries.
And 13.2 being the February 2017 bank payments report.
Moved by Councilor Bonney, supported by Councilor Bjorkman. Questions?
There we go.
All in favor? Motion carries. Any business?
Item 14 is the new business item added to the published agenda this evening by Councilor Bonney.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor. Actually, I'd like to pull up an email, but I don't know if I can find it. So I've been working with a group of grassroots individuals. Actually, one is in the audience right now, Heather Knight from Ward 2. And what we're doing is going to be doing like an open house in McGregor at the community center on May 3rd from 6:30 to 8:30. So my ask is of council, and I've been working with administration too, to see if we can promote it on our Facebook and perhaps help with copying of the flyers. So the whole purpose of the night is to target the Hidden Creek Lucier Estates area, and in terms of getting those residents out and informing them of how trap, neuter, release works with kittens and cats, because we have so many town programs that and we have funding. So we want to get people in that neighborhood out, but we also want to market it to the broader entire municipality of Essex, because the Humane Society will be coming out, some of our cat trap specialists in our town will be coming out. You know, it's an art to trap a colony of cats and bring them into the Humane Society and get them fixed. You might not think so, but there really is something to do with it. So, you know, rather than wait until the fall, if we can try to get some of these cats now, and I just wanted to let council know that this is what's happening, and to, you know, say if you know of, you know, Mr. Mayor, if you know of people in Essex Center that have colonies of cats, this is the night to have them come out. So it's Wednesday, May 3rd, from 6:30 to 8:30 at the McGregor Community Center. And if anybody has any questions, Heather can answer them.
Thank you very much for that. Deputy Mayor Milosz.
Just a comment. That's the first Wednesday of the month, so the mayor and I will not be able to attend, just to let you know. We have county council on the first Wednesdays of the month.
Yes, please. Oh, we originally tried to do it in Hidden Creek, but they were not. So there's a sense of urgency here, right? So we thought, you know, the later we wait in May, Like, we have to get to these cats and kittens, like, sooner. And I didn't even look at county council. I just was like, when's the first night we can do it? The room.
Thanks, Rich.
Item 15, notices motion. 15.1 was withdrawn at the request of the mover. 15.2 is Councillor Snively's notice of motion that administration prepare a community entrance sign to Ward 4, acknowledging it to being the home of Lionel Sanders.
Through your worship, just the council, you know, we have an individual here that had very, very successful results in the triathlon, and I think just to honor him and his accomplishments, like they did in Ruthven for Megan. I think it would be nice if you were coming into Harold, both ends on Main Street, just entering, I don't know what we would put on it, but the home of Lionel Sanders or something like that. Maybe a sign at the east end, one at the west end of town, which maybe even on Walker Road too. Well, you have three different entrances, maybe three signs. We don't have to spend, I don't think, a lot of money on them, but something nice, you know, his accomplishments, I think we're proud of him, and I think that would be nice in town. People see that, his accomplishments. So,
Councillor Bondi.
If we get that done, I appreciate it.
Okay. Councillor Bondi and then Mr. Sweet.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor. I think Doug has been aware of this before, too. We did bring this up at council before, and I think Doug was working on, like, a policy or a framework on how we can best market our athletes. I hear it all the time, too, Councillor Snively, that we should be doing more with Lionel Sanders because he is world known.
Mr. Sweet.
Through your worship, Councillor Bondi is correct. So you always want to be sensitive and have some criteria, just so every name, and in this case, Mr. Sanders, I think, is a candidate, same as what Megan Agosta was, as he's a world record holder and a triathlete. So I've got some prices, just so council's information. To enter gateway signs to do the Lexon with the artwork, which could vary, and then to buy that piece, approximately about $250 to $300. So I'm going to work and get a design done. I'll run it by Lionel first, so he's aware of what's happening, and we'll get those up probably in a couple months. So.
Thank you, sir. Councillor Vogt.
I think it's a great idea. I really do. But with that being said, is for the little bit of time and the little bit of work it takes, each center should have a recognition board. When I look at Ward 1, and I'm sure the mayor can reflect on it as I can, in terms of NHL, guys going on and playing in the NHL. We had Heinze, we had Sittler, we had the Crowder brothers. And actually, at the risk of sounding self-righteous, my nephew, Mark, is playing in the same league as equivalent to the NHL in Germany. And so we got all kinds of sports icons that make, you know, raise the bar and put their name on the sports page around the world. And we should just have a simple little drop down from our that itemizes and lists those sports athletes. We do it on the wall by the high school. I just think it'd be a great idea. Paint a sign, it's what, $250, you said, Doug? We should be doing that. And I'm sure Doug would and his team would enjoy rounding those people up, bringing them in, and let them know we're recognizing them. I'm sure Keith and Heinze and the guys would take great pride in knowing that the town of Essex is going to recognize them by putting their name on the entrances. You go to St. Thomas, I'm trying to think of the player there, Thornton, he's all over every entrance, so. Anyways, it's just some food for thought.
Okay. Anything else? I just have one question. I was in one of the businesses this morning, and the paper was out there, and someone was reading it, and it said, Lionel Sanders. And I says, yeah, that's our hero boy. You know, they were talking about him being in today's paper. Am I wrong? Because the guy said, no, he lives in Tecumseh. It says right here in the paper. He's from Tecumseh. Are there two Lionel Sanders? Does anyone know? He said he was talking about setting some record and everything. I didn't see the paper myself, but hopefully there aren't, because if there's only one, When I read the paper, I'll probably call the Windsor Star and tell them the kid's from Harrow. Kid, he's a young man, isn't he? 29 or 20-something. But anyways, nobody else has seen today's paper to let me know. Okay, I'll check myself. Councilor Vokes.
Thank you for the opportunity to speak. And I'll actually, if I could, make a motion, if it's fitting to do that, make a motion that we support putting a sports legend board at the bottom of our town entrance signs as a result of what Larry's trying to drive to do for Mr. Sanders.
Excuse me. I was just informed by our clerk that we have a motion on the table.
Oh, I'm sorry.
Without a seconder. So that's my fault. Councillor Caxero. And it's right here. So we're going to, ready for the question for this one? All in favor? Motion carries. Councilor Vokes.
And then obviously I'd like to put a motion for that we add a legend to the bottom of the town entrances, recognizing all our athletes that have made a monumental position in the sports world or in the endeavor.
Now, I'm recalling our entrances, like you said in your own words, we have quite a few. Mr. Sweet, you think we have room for all of that so people would be able to read them when they're coming in town? There's no sense putting it up there if it's too small that we can't read it. But, yes, sir.
Your Worship, I think you have to come up with some criteria. The gateway signs may not be the best location just because the speed you're going past. So I think what Councilor Vokes intent is, there should be some place within our municipality where we can recognize these individuals that hit a certain level. And maybe it's at the Essex Sports Complex, the Harrow Arena. I think we could do more research, but I think we need to come back on something like that.
No, actually, that's not, I appreciate the efforts, but that's not what I want. I really do want people to recognize as they're driving through. Because I noticed it in St. Thomas when Thornton was on there. I never knew he lived in St. Thomas. And as they come in, and I don't think the list is actually that long. I think Essex has maybe a half a dozen in total. And so,
but that's just hockey you're talking about.
No, I'm just I'm talking about any athlete who
is. But any athlete.
As a point of order, there's been a motion made. There's no seconder on the motion. This needs to be addressed.
No, I think we addressed that one. We voted on this one.
Councilor Vokes made a motion.
Yeah, we need a seconder. You're right. Again, I'm wrong. Do we have a seconder for this? Councilor Bergman.
I will second it for discussion.
Okay. So we've had a little bit of discussion. Councilor Vokes, we know what he wants, what Mr. Sweet said. Councilor Bergman, you're up.
Thank you, Worship. I like the idea. I like the idea of recognizing people who have attained a certain stature in the community. I think at this point, that's something we need to look into to say that we're going to. I don't think the entry signs are good. There's just not very much room at the bottom of them. They need to have a good spot if it's near the entry of the town, but beside it to one side as they're coming in. So let's have administration have a look at that and come back to us with it. That would be my suggestion.
Hey, thank you, sir. Anyone else? Comments? No? Councilor Caxero.
So what's the motion was to, at the bottom of the gateway signs, to recognize and the level or accomplishment wasn't defined. Is the motion being adjusted to reflect going to administration to explore?
It turned into something really confusing and complicated all of a sudden when it just means adding a couple signs somewhere. So, yes.
Okay.
Anything further? All in favor? Motion carries.
Agenda item 16, or new agenda item 16, as clarified during adoption of published agenda this evening, is reports from council members. Once again, Your Worship, this is a 5-minute opportunity. Not debatable, not for further discussion, 5-minute opportunity for council members to report to the rest of council on matters that they're currently working on. And so I open it up to reports from council members.
Anyone have a report they'd like to present to us? One says no.
Right. Fair enough.
No one's prepared on this side. Anyone on this side prepared? No? Okay. Remember that for our next meeting. Thank you. Announcements.
Yep.
Right?
Yep.
Next, Councilor Snively.
Through your worship, I'd just like council to know and the public to know we have a KFC elimination draw the last Saturday in April. It's a full rib dinner and the elimination draw for $30. I don't know how many tickets are left. At last I heard I'm on that committee, I think we have maybe 30 tickets left at the last meeting. So they might be sold out, I'm not sure. So, but it's the last Saturday of April. They're going to have entertainment, and it's quite a do. So.
That includes a meal?
Yes.
Wow. Thanks. Any other announcements? There are none. I have one. I just want to let everyone know, if you haven't heard, that the Essex 73s played the seventh and final game of the season for them in the semifinals of the Junior C Smaltz Cup fight. We lost 2-1 last night. We had the 1-0 leading to the end of, or to the third period. Gave up 2 goals, lost to a, I don't know if it's an A team or a B team, but we're a Junior C team. And I just want to say to the executive, first of all, another great season, great job. Coaching staff led by Scott Miller, who's the general manager, and the coach, Cam Crowder. Great job, coaching staff, and especially the players. Like I say, we have a Junior C team here. We're playing against a whole bunch of Junior B players, the odd Junior C, and there's a handful almost of former Junior A players as late as this year. You represented your league and our town as better, as good as anyone could have expected and beyond. Again, like, I don't know what this organization does, but boy, oh boy, they bring the best of these young men when they're playing hockey. And they're good people around the town, too, because they work in our municipality. You see them daily, you know. So I just want to say, from all of us in the town, thanks again for a great year. And boy, the future's in good hands, I'll tell you. Councilor Snively.
Through your worship, I just respond to that, too. That was great hockey, and congratulations to them. Last night's game, I guess, that goaltender of ours stood on his head. 50-something shots compared to 20-something. Yeah, that is something. So to lose 2-1, that was a hell of a game. So.
And I forgot to say that we own the record, the Essex 73s, for the most schmaltz All Ontario Championships. We own the record. Thanks.
Under bylaws, and bylaws for third and final reading, 1587 to adopt a heritage grant program for designated properties within the town of Essex.
Moved by Councilor Bjorkman, supported by Deputy Mayor Milosh. Questions? All in favor? Motion carries.
1596, being the confirming bylaw from the April 3rd, 2017 meeting.
Support.
Support by Councilor Bondi and Councilor Caxero. Questions? All in favor? Carries.
Bylaws for first, second, and third reading this evening. 1599, being a bylaw to amend bylaw 224, the bylaw to regulate parking. This relates to the restricted parking at the Essex Center Sports Center for the electric vehicle parking spaces.
Councillor Snively and Councillor Caxero, questions? All in favor? Motion carries. Oh, sorry, Councillor Snively.
Has anybody seen a zip-in used, Doug? Do you know?
Through your worship, it has been used, and that's why we had to get this bylaw through. People were parking those spaces, and the vehicles could not get access.
Oh, really?
Yeah.
Okay. Thanks.
18, or sorry, next Next bylaw for three readings this evening is 1600, being a bylaw to enter into a second dwelling agreement between the Corporation of the Town of Essex and Charles Peter and Joan Marguerite McMillan to demolish the existing home after the occupancy of a newly constructed dwelling.
Moved by Councilor Cacchero, supported by Deputy Mayor Malosh. Questions? All in favor? Motion carries.
Bylaw 1602, being a bylaw between the court, or being a bylaw with the Corporation of the Town of Essex to authorize a tax arrears extension agreement.
Moved by Councilor Bjorkman, supported by Councilor Vokes. Any questions? All in favor? Carries.
And for first and second reading this evening is 1601, being the confirming bylaw for this April 18th, 2017 meeting.
Councilor Vokes and Councilors Bjorkman. Questions? All in favor? Motion carries. Adjournment. Councilor Cacchero and Councilor Bonney. Questions? All in favor? Motion carries. Have a great evening, everyone.